on RTE, your only national station. The romance and passion of Spain are explored with Gerard Collins in Around the World on 80 Grand.
While most people are familiar with the cheap package tours to Spain, at the moment one can take advantage, and I always enjoy doing that, of a special one-off and very exclusive Madrid Club Med 60-85 summit. Mingle freely with the Arabs, the Israelis, the Russians and the Americans. Lunch with one crowd, dinner with another. A popular item on the tour is the daily discussions, and they're grand if you're in the mood, but for real excitement, I found that Madrid has lots to offer with a striking selection of camera crews, all of whom are most anxious to hear your views on the holiday. A leisurely tour of these crews will, I discovered, fill up the morning nicely. A visit to the Prado was strongly recommended to me, but the Spanish food doesn't agree with me, so I haven't gone there as yet. Somebody did ask me about the paella. They are painful, but they've cleared up and I'm walking freely again. Travel broadens the mind, of course, so you have to be careful of that. It's like that Gianni De Michaelis fellow who annoys me sometimes, going on about reading and books and so on. It can't be good for him. Whereas for me, I like travel to be just like life at home, sweet home. Luxury accommodation, chauffeur-driven car, loads of free grub and the bullfights, which are just like the Dáil, really, especially the part where the bull is tormented and taunted. Although, of course, unlike at home in Madrid, the bull is actually killed off and carted away. That takes courage, of course, so I tried on a matador's outfit later and I thought it really looked good on me. As soon as they get the buttons sewn back on, I'll slip into it again and try out a few moves, see what it feels like to deliver the killer blow.
A reading from the Book of Manipulations, Chapter 6, The Parable of the Fly. And it came to pass that the Lord did send two of the family of Paul to be our guide and comfort in this vale of tears. Paul the prophet, who is called Bono, and Paul, who makes profit and is called manager. And Paul the prophet, who is also Bono, saw a blinding flash on the road to the record studio, and so did wear a strange black band around his eyes, which was truly an affectation. Alleluia. And it was near the time of year when the Savior's birth is celebrated that messengers were sent out to all the synagogues of the faithful, each bearing a holy disc with a revelation on it from Paul the prophet, who is called Bono, David the music maker, who is the edge, Adam, who was naked but is not the first, and Larry, who is definitely the last. And this revelation did speak to all the world in one tongue and one time. And the disc did appear in a shining vision above all temples of music, also called outlets. And the words of Paul, who is also manager, were heard throughout the world. This holy disc will appear but 21 days and 21 nights. Then it will be no more. And all who have it not by then will be unclean, and fit only to lie down with beasts of the field, or Chesney hawks. And his word was heard, and it was good. And the faithful thronged the streets to sing his praise, and take the holy disc unto themselves, and its number was one. Responsorial psalm. The response is, like a fly on the wall, it's no secret at all.
Like a fly on the wall, it's no secret at all.
O Lord, thank you for Paul and David and Adam and even poor little Larry. We do not deserve to be bestowed with such gifts as these, your holy prophets.
If I was able to drive and had a wish to purchase for myself one of those, you know, motor car things, the last person I'd ask for advice would be a soft-voiced poet from Kerry who's never owned a car in his life. But there you are, so there's no accounting for taste. Toyota, when you don't know any better.
It's got to be Yes, boss.
Mara?
Boss?
We've done it, PJ. We've saved the country from a return to showband power.
Yes, boss.
Oh, PJ, I like the way you planted that story on Friday morning. Front page of the Times. Middle ground TDs backing away from Albert. Wonderful stuff.
Thanks, boss.
Self-fulfilling publicity. Dr. Goebbels, eat your heart out. Wasn't it he that said, tell them the big lie. Come here to me, her Dr. Mara. Mine Troyer, PJ.
Ah, boss!
You know, sometimes I can almost tolerate you.
Ah, boss.
Now to business.
Yes, boss. I'm heading in there. I have everything organised.
Good man, Mara. May life on you. Keep this up and you can have a big future with me. I'm proud of you. It's all attended to then.
Indeed. The Office of Public Works will move your personal files to Kinsealy, no charge. Your souvenirs, jewel daggers and framed court discharge sheet, etc. are all ready to be boxed.
Ow! You're what's ready to be boxed, Mara.
Oh!
What are you at, man?
I was getting everything ready for...
For?
The evacuation, the move, decamping, calling it a day.
That will be the day, Mara. Come here till we have one of our little chats. Friend, showman and press secretary, lend me your ear.
Let go of me ear.
May I take it that I have your undivided attention?
Oh, yes, boss.
Let's have a little lesson in logic.
Yes, boss.
What did I say about Master Bertie last week?
That he was the most devious, cunning person in government.
And if I said that, it must therefore, ipso facto, be...
Half true. An outright lie.
Correct. Because the only one qualified to judge who is the most brilliant, devious, cunning bastard is...
The most devious, cunning bastard himself.
Who is therefore...
You, boss!
Correct. Time frame. Time frame my arse. Christmas is coming and Reynolds is getting squat.
Squat?
Diddly, niente, nada. Nothing, Mara. If winter comes, can the budget be far behind? An upturn in the economy, perhaps? But yet a shitty budget for old Fido food? EC summits, Anglo-Irish talks, safe pair of hands, man of stature? Get Cronin on the phone. I'd like something lyrical for my speech.
Speech, boss?
Yes, Mara. My Ordesh speech.
Oh, boss.
The Provisional IRA, your only national terrorist group... wishes to advertise a vacancy for the post of Quality Controller, Bombs Division. As part of a general expansion program, we hope to recruit someone whose expertise will guarantee a higher death rate per bomb, so vital in the highly competitive world of terrorism today. The successful candidate may choose whether the bombs he works on murder people in the occupied territory only, or kills them in Britain also. Naturally, a bonus scheme will operate in the latter case. Basic intelligence, such as not leaving your fingerprints on the bombs, will be an asset, but not essential, as top-class legal aid will be provided by the company in the event of difficulties. Reply with references from a parish priest and a fellow traveller, and complete the following sentence. I like blowing people up with a really good quality bomb because, in 10 words or less, the Provisional IRA is not an equal opportunities employer.
I used to sit for hours on end in Bewley's, seducing beautiful women with my sexy voice and my soft poetry amidst the exotic aroma of fresh brewed coffee. Now I just dangle the keys of my Toyota and they sacrifice themselves on the altar of my reclining seats. Toyota, for the ride of a lifetime.
It's got to be.
Is on like Shay Healy, and that's starting on Network 2, our only other national broadcasting channel. Achanisher Balakahain, BB. Hello and welcome, Avini Oos.
Councillor. Well, I can hardly contain myself, because tonight my exclusive guest is the most powerful man in Ireland, if not, in fact, in the world. So, Boulibus Mór Acordia for the manager of U2, Paul McGuinness. Oh, Paul, my little heart's going pit-a-pat already. You really are here. And I see you've brought copies of the new single. One for everyone in the audience, is it?
Perhaps, BB. I'll certainly be happy to sell them to anyone in the audience who deserves to buy one. But, of course, I'll give you one for free, BB.
Oh, stop! And they're so hard to get, aren't they? I managed to buy 300 copies myself, but I had to go scurrying around Dublin for them. And the queues! But I'm a much better person as a result. I realise that much.
Yes, I think that the days are gone when people think that they can just walk into any megastore and pick up a U2 record. My client's very unhappy with this situation, so we've done something about it.
Yes, you really do have to prove yourself to be a U2 fan. No cultishin cart.
Yes, and quite rightly so. My clients demand respect, and I get it for them.
Now, this oath of allegiance that the fans have to take before buying a concert ticket, is it proving popular?
Very much so, as is the erection of statues and altars to the group in people's back gardens.
Mm.
In fact, fans wishing to buy the new album will have to provide architects' plans and evidence of planning permission for their altar.
And of course, this album of full will only be on sale between midnight and 1 a.m. on the night of a full moon, isn't that right?
Yes, provided that the buyer can produce references from at least 3 reliable sources, particularly a source as beautiful as yourself, BB.
Oh, no! Oh, that trouser material is so soft.
Thank you,
Bibi. And tell me now, Fata, is it very tiresome dealing with all these people who want to spend their money on U2 records, stickers, posters, T-shirts and concerts? Would you not rather do without all that re-rogs rouille-boulle?
Well, sometimes I do say to Paul and David and Adam...
Larry...
No, Larry's usually left in the car with a Coke and a packet of crisps. Anyway, I say, look, chaps, let's do things that will really get rid of these rather tiresome fans. And the boys agree, because, of course, they are geniuses and they need the creative freedom to behave in any way I like.
Oh, they sound like such mature, sensible boys.
Indeed. And you sound just like Gay Byrne.
Oh, just keeping in practice, you know. Well, that's all we've time for on the Late Late... I mean, on BB. So roll it there, Roisin. Agus slán agaibh go léir. Slán, bye!
All right, indeed. Now, the tradition of the pantomime dame is a long and honourable one, and tonight we, as it were, take a peek underneath the many skirts of one of the most wonderful old dames of Dublin, one of the greats.
Some used to say Jack Cruise, there'll never be another dame like Jack Cruise. Others would say, no, give me Jimmy O'D any day. But for the true connoisseur, for those with a real eye for the genuine article, the greatest pantomime dame of them all was Jimmy Tunney.
Ah, yes, the yellow rose of Finglas himself, Biddy Tunney, the pride of the Doyle. Maureen, what was he like?
Oh, you may well ask, Mike. He had the most outrageous outfit, all fornias and funny hats and grey suits. But what really set him apart was the way he would stand there looking at the front row as if they were muck.
And he had this catchphrase, I love my leader. Well, it used to bring the house down.
But not the leader, of course. And it was that marvellous accent he put on that people found so funny, wasn't it?
Oh, absolutely, Mike. I mean, it was like nothing on earth.
Trying to be posh, you know, but coming out all wrong.
I mean, no human being ever spoke like that, really, but it was so funny.
Interrupt if you dare, but I'm full of hot air, and you know I can outlast you all. Excuse me, I didn't interrupt you, so let me say my miss. I'm a windy old giss, Biddy Tunney, the pride of the Doyle.
It really brings it all back, doesn't it? Maureen had her Christie, and Biddy had his who? Who was that?
Ah, yes, that was a great act. That was Charles.
And now, Charles, he was the boss. Wasn't that the idea?
Yeah. And that was terrible funny, all right.
He also had, a celebrated prop. Tell us about that.
He had this terrible long tongue.
And no one else actually, and this is the idea, no one else actually had a tongue as long as that, had they?
That's right, no. A terrible length of a tongue altogether. And the trick of it was, we'd all be waiting for it, you know, to see how far up Charles's...
The derriere.
That's right, his arse, the tongue would go.
Hilarious, yeah. We'll never see his like again.
Ah, with the help of God, Mike.
Oh, my leader and king, I would do anything to make sure that my chalice won't fall. I'll shout till I'm hoarse, and I'll grovel, of course, just to keep me in charge of the Dáil. Me boys, be de Tunny, the pride of the Dáil.
Yeah, it's so nostalgic, isn't it? But David Norris, it was basically a drag act.
Oh, absolutely. Biddy Tunney was in a tradition going back to the Victorian days. He was of that era, really, and very camp.
Indeed, yes. Almost effeminate, really.
Absolutely. And when he would shout down, "Yes, are only a crowd of dirty poofters," just like an old fishwife selling her wares. We'll never forget Biddy Tunney, the pride of the Dáil.
So he was in fact known as Biddy Tunney.
Well, he will be now, Mike.
Elder statesman and prince, though I do like to mince my words, but that's no harm at all. The state's never seen such a pantomime queen. Biddy Tunney, the pride of the Dáil. Me boys, Biddy Tunney, the pride of the Dáil.
Yes, of course. And he strongly opposed the homosexual law reform, didn't he?
That's right, Mike. He had quite a hysterical monologue he used to do about it.
So let's finish then with this tribute on that famous monologue from Biddy Tunney, a great old relic and a wonderful pantomime dame.
Who's the man to lead our country, says I? Charles J. Hoy, says I. Why is that, says he? Because he is not a homosexual, says I. I mean, homosexuals are all very well, and I don't say that we should send out the police to willy-nilly arrest them, says I. Order willy-nillies, says he. That's enough of that talk, says I. These fellas are only fudge packers, aren't they? And shirtlifters, aren't they? And fishers of the brown trout.
Going great guns on the road between Dingle and Dunquin. It was sleek and sensual. I was completely in control, though I'd never felt such power beneath me before. The movement rhythmic and explosive. I was relaxed, king in my own kingdom county. When next thing this Toyota drove by and nearly ran over the two of us. I'll stick to the fields in future.
It's got to be
And now on RTE, your only national broadcasting station, we have your only national religion, Nightlight with Father Pat McGuinness.
Hi, how are you doing? Did you ever feel like a fly on the wall? Did you ever don a pair of wraparound dark glasses so as to be completely unobtrusive as you went about your daily business? Come to think of it, what is your daily business? Do you, let's say, work on a building site, or do you manipulate the pop music industry? Either way, you know, every job has its problems. As was said in the first letter of St. Paul to the susceptible, for man will rise and man will crawl. And so inevitably, you see, we all start wanting to be a fly on the wall. I would love to be a fly on the wall, for example, when you two meet their accountant. Bono himself, as we all know, is a fly on the wall, or a Wall Street banker, or the destroyer of the Berlin Wall, or Adolf Hitler or Vaclav Havel, depending on what hour of the day you meet him, what the weather is like, and what kind of car he's in at the time. It must be great to be whatever you like, but you know, the hardest thing is to be yourself. And in a way, that's what the new U2 album is all about. They are just being themselves, being number one, making sure they are number one. It's a dance album because U2 just want everyone to dance to their tune. So when begrudgers and unbelievers ask, why should you only have 3 weeks in which to buy the new U2 single? Answer, four legs good, two legs bad. That'll put them in their place and keep Bono in his. Now let's give baby Jesus a special little present for his birthday. Let's make Achtung Baby number one for Christmas. Good night now and God bless.
The cheek of those gutter snipes.
Dick Spring. How dare he call me a liar? Mara, do something about him.
Yes, boss.
Tired of reading press hype about his assured handling of issues in the Doyle. He handles national issues as well as he handled a rugby ball. if memory serves me, that wasn't so very...
Yes, boss.
I have to laugh at these charges that I, of all people, indulge in nepotism. Anyone would think that I'd imposed my son, what's this his name? Is the one with the moustache?
Sean.
Yes, that I had imposed him on Dublin North Central.
North East. Not that you did, boss. How dare anyone suggest that?
Just because Kieran is my son, this fella, the stockbroker.
Damn it, Desmond.
Yeah, right, him, who I scarcely know. That his company sent confidential information on Irish helicopters to Kieran. But what about Butterfingers from Tralee? How did he get to be leader of Labour? Go down to the Labour HQ and say, oh, I'd like to join up. Certainly, sir. In fact, I'd like to be leader. Oh, it's not as easy as that, sir. My father was Dan Spring. Oh, why didn't you say, step this way? You can be leader right away. And yet Dick, unwittingly, stands there in that chamber and points his butterfinger at me over Bernie Cahill.
Boss, you did actually say that you didn't meet Bernie Cahill.
Of course I did. How am I supposed to remember all the Bernie Cahills I meet in any particular day?
Boss.
Hundreds of them. And I'm supposed to remember that I met Bernie Cahill, the chairman of the...
Green Car.
Yes, I remember... Certainly, Kieran dropping in that day, parking the helicopter and slipping inside to get something or other. And while he was there, I did have a conversation with his passenger to pass the time. But Mara, can you imagine me suggesting, much less telling, him or anybody else to use NCB during the privatisation of...
Green Car, no, boss.
Does that sound like me?
Oh, it does not, boss.
Would it be me to go give this to Desmond?
It's ludicrous, boss. Absolutely ludicrous.
Sometimes, Mara, all I see is black. Gloom.
Ah, cheer up, boss. Look on the bright side.
There isn't any bright side, Mara.
Senator Donny Cassidy? Allegations that he used the Dáil TV facilities to edit a Foster and Allen video.
Doubtless he will rebut these scurrilous charges.
Oh, doubtless he will, boss.
There'll be wigs on the green for this, I tell you. I'd take my hat off to him.
Except he won't take his hair off to you.
Oh, no. No one will pull the rug over his eyes.
Let the hair sit.
Foster and Allen. Why me, Mara? Why? What is it about me that attracts that particular breed of gobshite?
And joining me now from the courts is Tomás McRory. Now, Tomás, you had a particularly disturbing case this afternoon.
Yes, Miles. Before the court were four young men and one older man, all accused of demanding money with menaces.
And this presumably was a gang.
Well, the four young men insisted that they should be called a group rather than a gang. The four were named as Paul Hewson, David Hewson, Larry Hewson and Adam Hewson. And the prosecution alleged that they had conspired on or about the 10th of this month to take a large sum of money from a number of young people.
And what was their modus operandi? What scam was it they employed?
Well, Miles, over the last few years, these four men were alleged to have made freely available certain substances for which many young impressionable people had added, quickly acquired a habit.
Do we know exactly what the substance is?
Yes, Miles, it was apparently vinyl and on other occasions variously chrome dioxide and even the ecstasy drug CD. And they'd also flooded the market with a large amount of a substance known as HYPE or hype as it's known in the vernacular. The court was also told that this combination of HYPE and vinyl and indeed CD was a particularly intoxicating cocktail from which the four accused had made huge profits.
So what exactly had drawn attention to these people?
A number of tip-offs and certain confidential information which the Gardaí had received.
And what was that?
Specifically the cover of a Time magazine.
Was there a mitigating plea?
Well, summing up, the judge, Justice Brennan, said it was clear to him that the four men were of diminished responsibility. And Paul Hewson gave his name as Bono and his address as Medjugorje. The judge remanded Hewson until a psychiatric report was furnished to the court. David Evans was given 1 year on the back of the Sunday Indo, and Clayton, who stood in the dock with his head bowed stark naked, was ignored, but not by several of the Gardaí in the body of the court. Of Larry Mullen, Justice Brennan said it was pointless to give him time, as he wouldn't be able to keep it, and remanded him to the juvenile court.
And what of the fifth man?
Well, Justice Brennan had strong words indeed for the fifth man, and dealing with him separately, he said he believed that he had influenced the four younger men. The fifth man was named as Mr. Paul McGuinness, whom the judge described as, quote, a good-time guy who clearly led the four young men astray and a modern-day Fagin living off the immoral earnings of four helpless waifs, and who, thanks to him, now had a criminal record, or two.
And sentence?
Well, Miles, the judge said that an ordinary fine would not deter such a man, and only the loss of an extremely large amount of money was likely to have any impact. So he withdrew the TV3 licence. And at this stage, and this is what the judge found particularly serious, it was at this stage that Mr. McGuinness bit the Garda on the penis.
I have never met any of the people involved in this scandal, be it Dermot Morgan or Paulie McLean or Jonathan White. I know none of these people. It is alleged that this document was written by Dermot Morgan and Gerard Stembridge, but that again has never been proven outside of this house. The whole business has undoubtedly been engineered by Lachlan Butler Jr. And the director was, in my view, in my belief, Gerard Stembridge. But who was the chairman?
Recorded at Real Good Studios, Dublin, Scrap Saturday is from Q Productions for RTE.